Hello on the Rockers. On this episode, it's MTV hottie Mike Mulderrig, X on the Beach, All-Star Shore, Lindsay Lohan's Beach Club, coming to spill the tea about reality TV. And is he walking away? According to his highly popular YouTube channel, perhaps we're going to get that scoop along with our pop culture report from model Steven Dehler, my guest co-host tonight, and me, your favorite host with the sassy most. Raise a glass and let the drinks begin. It's on the rocks.
Banquet, and most poor suckers are starving to death.
I'd like to propose a toast.
This is On the Rocks with Alexander, where I drink with your favorite celebrities as we talk about fashion, entertainment, pop culture, reality TV, and, well, that's about it. So pop a cork, lean back, and raise a glass to On the Rocks.
Fasten your seatbelt. It's going to be a bumpy night.
Yes, indeed. Buttons and bows and pantyhose. On the Rocks podcast, a place where we're too glam to give a damn. First, thank you so much, Facebook, for restricting me for 60 days for a post I made 4 years ago. Thanks for being on top of it. Of course, there's racism and homophobia going all over Facebook, but you stopped me for Jeffrey Dahmer. Awesome. Oh, it was a Jeffrey Dahmer joke around Thanksgiving. Yes, it was tasteless. Yes, I regret it, but come on. Thanks, Facebook, if you're still on Facebook. Like us on Twitter and Instagram at On The Rocks on Air. And if you're not restricted on Facebook, On The Rocks Radio Show, send me an email, book me for a wedding, funeral, quinceañera, bris. I don't care. I will show up. Info at ontherocksradioshow.com. The show is presented by Straw Hut Media. You can watch and or listen to our over 300 episodes at ontherocksradioshow.com. You can watch us on Apple TV, Roku, Amazon Fire TV, on the out.tv app. Of course, we are on Facebook Watch, live sometimes, streaming with pride on SVTV, and on Channel 31 on the East Coast. Hello, Channel 31. All right, let's get the show on the road. My guest co-host today, making his return, Steven Dehler, runway and print model, also a classic pianist. You've seen a model for Marco Marco and other tight-fitting brands, and if you're a romance novel reader, you have literally seen him on tons of covers, gay, straight. There was one with a horse once. I know it was there. He also serves as our resident pop culture correspondent, who will be bringing his pop culture review to us mid-show. So stay tuned for that. Please welcome Steven Dehler.
I need to see this damn horse.
It's like masculine, whatever. It's like a horse with like muscles, and it's like, is he stable? I mean, it was literally that ridiculous.
Oh man, yeah, there's a few of them.
Okay, anyway, it's been a hot minute since you've been here, and we're gonna get into all the pop culture stuff you have for us. But First, you're a big Britney fan. You probably shit your pants when she became free.
Yes, that was very exciting for a lot of us.
So as of yesterday and today, people are saying, well, maybe her conservatorship wasn't so...
You know, that's such a BS kind of thing, because for anyone to just think that she should be back into like that situation just because she's speaking her mind, and you know, she's been in a conservatorship for 14 years almost. And she did say that she's in therapy, right? So this is a lot of her. She came out today saying, you know, she projects a lot of stuff, a lot of her insecurities. So at least she's aware of it. But, you know, I don't think that we should be that harsh on her just because of some of the things that she says about some other people.
Well, she did say also that she's never going to perform live again.
I mean, she said probably. I mean, you know, with Britney, I mean, she'll delete her Instagram one day and then she'll bring it back up the next day. We thought that she wasn't going to have any music at all. And then she already has a song out with Elton John.
What do you think of it? Honestly.
I like it. And I like, and she's supposedly having a song come out with, was it The Weeknd for his show The Idol?
Well, you heard what she said about Christina Aguilera, that if she cast fat dancers, she would look skinny too.
She said the whole thing about the meme, and then it was about, I think, yeah, she, I saw that was the whole thing that she came out with today, where she's like, well, she never mentioned Christina Aguilera's body. She just was saying that when she was at her concert, that she, you know, she was just jealous of the fact that she got to choose her own dancers.
This is how I know she's with it, because that was a smart joke, because she didn't say it, but she said it.
Yeah.
Our girl joke.
It was shady for sure, but. Yeah. You know, she ignored Christina Aguilera's shade for how many years, and you know, she probably has that built up over the years.
One day we're going to do a debate, Christina versus Britney, and we're not going to be able to use Crossroads or Burlesque.
I think that eventually someday they'll probably perform together. I think they'll have a single together. They've already performed together with Madonna, so we've already seen them perform.
Maybe they'll perform at her funeral, the other queen. The other old queen who's almost there.
You know.
Wouldn't that be funny, though, if they sing at her funeral? Oh, my God. And Lady Gaga pop up and go, huh?
Right? Oh,
we're so dumb.
Oh, man.
Anyway, our guest of honor today, please welcome MTV personality Mike Mulderrig from X on the Beach, All Star Shore, and Lindsay Lohan's Beach Club. In addition to his time on reality TV, he's also a thriving YouTube, running his channel, MikeMGTV, as well as co-host the popular podcast, MessyPod. His TikTok is fire. His Instagram is fire. His OnlyFans is fire. I kid.
I was gonna be
but
like,
I would subscribe. Mm-hmm.
I was gonna say.
Please welcome Mike and his peaches, Mulderrig.
Hi. Where did you get these photos?
Girl, we do research.
I was gonna say.
Steven knows. Like, I will. Ooh. I'll pull up your report card. I'll find your yearbook.
He'll find your first performance from like third grade or something.
Yeah. I almost played Nick Mask's mugshot, but I didn't because I'm a gentleman. Anyway, we're gonna get to know. So we know about you on reality TV, but I want to know a little bit about beforehand.
Thank you.
You are a production intern, yep. Accounting manager with marketing and communications. Like, this was your job. You were like behind the scenes.
Yeah.
How did that kind of shift to appearing on screen? And what the hell was your audition like for Lindsay Lohan's Beach Club?
I never auditioned. They came to the Abbey. Because, okay, the team
The
was...
Abbey were all your dreams.
Yeah, because I was a PA, and as we all know, PAs make no money.
Yeah.
So I
in reality TV, it's the only industry that nobody's fighting for the rights of overworked camera people, production crew, like literally.
Well,
they need to form a union.
Like, we got treated like nothing, and then I just happened to walk by the Abbey. And by the way, like I've only
was
ever...
Lindsay there with like her head in the gutter, being like, "Come in my show."
I wish. But no, I walked by the Abbey.
That's it.
I got a job, and they came in and they were just like, "Hey, do you want to work in Greece for the summer?" I thought it was a job. And then
I thought it was the musical.
I just got a job there, and then they were like, by the way, we're going to film it. It's going to be a TV show. And I was like, okay, cool. And then they took my pants off and got fired.
See, Mike, you're giving this false reality of what happens when you come to LA that you're
it's
just discovered.
Happened. No, I always tell people, you know what? LA is all about, you know, you have to put yourself in the right spot. You know what I mean? Because
girl, I've been passed out at the Abbey plenty. Nobody's calling.
But you get. I mean, you got to put yourself in the right spot, and you got to like act right when you're there. Like, I'm not somebody who acts right all the time. Trust me.
Girl, I've seen.
Yes.
But, on camera.
But like bartending, like
literally on camera.
Bartending, everybody wants to like you to like them. Everybody comes to me, and then they want to talk to the bartender. So it was a good way to meet people and network.
You know what I like about you, Mike? And this is from all your projects. Getting to know you personally is like you own your shit. You know, there's so many of the reality TV people, some that are our frenemies in our same circle. Mm-hmm. They put on such a false persona of them on the show, or they come here on the show, and they're so full of shit.
It's like, bitch,
you own your stuff.
They
you
do it
own your faults.
And that's why I think they like me on these shows, because I call it out. We call it posing on the show. And I'm like, don't do that.
Yeah.
Do not do that. And one of the people, it was hard for me to do a show with, like, for X on the Beach, it was hard for me to do it with my best friend, Arise, because, like, we've never done a show together, and we're each other's best friend.
That was
so,
a lot
like,
to handle.
Yeah, tell me about it.
So, I mean, I want to talk about reality TV a little bit later, but X on the Beach, you know, when I first had somebody on the show, I was like, shit, I got to watch the show. And then like four episodes in, I'm like, oh, when's the next one? On the surface, I thought, oh, God, a bunch of pretty people fucking each other.
It's what it should have been.
But you know, all jokes aside,
yeah.
All jokes aside, it really has brought light to the relationship arena of what's happening with the younger generation.
Yeah. Well, also, they didn't know how to handle queer people.
Yeah.
Like, me and Arise were going in, and first of all, everyone said I gaslit her. I let her know exactly what was going to happen. She wanted to be open, and I didn't. So I said, you want to see open? I'm going to hook up with people in front of you. And then when I did, she's like, you're a cheater, you're a monster, you're an asshole, and everyone just sided with her and said I was a monster. She gaslit me. And then it won. But it was like, what was the question?
What I'm saying, though, is like it actually shed light on some of the turmoil of dating. It's not like when I grew up and I'm not even talking about gay or bisexual, all that. I'm talking about just like you were in a relationship or you were not in a relationship. Now we have terms like fluid, but now a younger MTV generation is growing up with terms like trans, like non-binary, like fluid. We never had that when I was watching MTV growing up.
Yeah.
And it's giving identity to some of these young kids. It's like, yeah, dating is shit and it's crazy, but there's also these terms. There's also this opportunity for me to be myself.
That's where I was going. And now I remember that they do.
Girl, it's like 5 minutes
it's
in question
show.
Number one.
I'm getting it. They do. The representation is great, but production, there needs to be queer producers to produce queer people.
100%. So my friend Jeff Marks, he just won the Emmy Award as a casting director, and he has been in the queer community forever.
Yeah.
And his biggest thing is
you know, we may in front of the camera have evolved, but people behind the camera have not. People in the offices, people who doing the PR, people who are, you know, PR assistants, they don't get queer culture. Mm-mm. And so certain areas were not represented. Sometimes we are being taken advantage of, and the token storyline.
Oh, yeah, because, like, imagine me and Aris were like, okay, let's be open. They have no idea what to do. They're like, what do you mean open? They're like, okay, well, I love her, but I'm just going to, like, sleep with other people in the house. And they're like, what? How do we produce this? So I was like, okay, yeah. And they had no idea what to do. And then they brought in queer producers and knew exactly how to get us on the inside.
Now, going to Lindsay Lohan's Beach Club, you came from marketing. Did you have a little strategy to get camera time? I mean, your reality TV persona really blew up real fast.
Yeah.
You were on all the major networks. Mm-hmm. Everybody was talking about your social media, everything. You had to have been aware of how to make that happen.
But if you try, it doesn't work because people can tell. Like, I'm not an actor. And that's what people think. They're like, oh, reality TV is scripted. None of us are going on, like, an acting audition. They just want to know who's a mess. And they want to know
they just
who's
put you in social situations where you can live up to your potential of messiness.
Yes. And then they get mad at you when you do that, by the way.
Exactly. Yeah. Like, if you look, every show I've been on, I've only ever fought with the people I was friends with previously because they were the ones I actually cared about. It's the truth because, I mean, there was no... I mean, obviously, I watch Housewives. I love Housewives. So the only thing I told myself was I'm going to go there. I'm not going to not do anything. I don't care if I look bad.
So I've been on a couple of the Bravo TV shows, and I'm sure we all have. There are some things that they've stopped a whole crowd and be like, hey, we have to take that back and say this over again. It's like,
yeah,
that they do.
Yeah. That's happened on all three shows I was on.
That they do. I remember on Lindsay Lohan's Beach Club, I got in a huge fight with my friend Alex. It was like a big deal. But then we were like, we're close. So the next morning, I'm like, hey, we're good. He goes, yeah, we're good. And producers like, no.
Yeah.
You guys can't make up yet. We have to do like a whole dramatic thing. So the fight was real. That was all real. But it's scripted reality.
But I think MTV
is... they have to keep the storyline.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I think MTV is more real than Bravo TV. And I'm generalizing from the LA Bravo shows.
At times, they're all different. Like MTV's more ratchet than Bravo.
I mean, it's always been that way since, like, the first Real World, really.
Yeah. It's just MTV, the things that are allowed to happen. And honestly, we can't do the old things. It's not legal. You can't make Jersey Shore the first five seasons.
Yeah, of course. No. Yeah.
Imagine going out and grabbing people and then fucking them. And can I curse on this? I didn't even
know. A little bit. My mom's watching. She's like, she says, tell Mike to watch his mouth.
But, like, imagine doing that, sleeping with somebody, and then body shaming them when they leave and making it on shirts. Like,
but
that would never happen.
Welcome to West Hollywood. No, but also Real World, and I'm a few minutes older than you guys, just a few, but like Real World was the first time I had seen the young generation talk about AIDS, talk about gay people. I mean, it had never been there. It also talked about addiction, talked about alcoholism, talked about abuse, and that was the Real World. Bravo TV was not doing that on Queer Eye for the straight guy. You know, that just was not happening.
No, it's all feel good. But until the Housewives, then it became messier a little bit.
Yeah.
But I still think that they're not dealing with real issues. Like on Housewives, what an opportune time to show women of a certain age be entrepreneurs and supporting each other. But they don't talk about ageism. They don't talk about being single and older.
They used to when the show was good.
Yeah. I think a lot of people just watch it like mind-numbingly just to watch people arguing.
And it was fun. I think it's gotten very vicious. It's gotten so vicious.
Super
and it was just
vicious.
Fun. Did you hear all the shit with NeNe Leakes and Andy Cohen?
I saw she was going on Watch What Happens Live. Is that
true? No, it can't be.
Oh, I thought I saw that on Twitter.
All these lawsuits are like coming to light.
Oh, really?
They're suing each other left and right. Oh, allegedly.
I saw someone tweet that she was going on Watch What Happens Live, and I was like, what?
I would be surprised at that. Sure.
Although that would be good TV.
I'm spreading false information.
That's how it gets spread.
Anyway, Mike, I made a joke about your butt and your peaches being a focus. Mm. It has been. You know,
it's
people from
butt.
Both sides. It's amazing. It's Italian.
I never get to see it. It's a shame.
But, girl, Helen Keller can see your butt. But you know, your sexuality, your haughtiness factor has become part of your persona. Mm-hmm. You know, it is a focus, gay, straight, it doesn't matter. Is there a point when, like, all the sex talk was like enough, and the pressure with dealing with everybody looking at your body from show to show, from season to season, from Instagram to real life or whatever, when you're like, hey, did you ever feel the pressure or overshadowed by that sex part of you? It's like, well, hey, I'm a real human being and I have other talents and this is what I do.
Absolutely. That's why I don't lead with it. I think let's be real. Sex sells. The body sells. Like if I want to get more likes on Instagram, let me be like in a piece of underwear just to prove to myself that I can get it.
Yeah.
I feel like your reach doesn't even go as far unless you're like more naked.
Exactly. Well, because you need those like engagements to push it in the first hour.
Mm. Well, and you know this from your classical pianist videos on YouTube. Amazing talent.
Anything I post where I have a shirt, even just a shirt on with my chest showing, that will get like a fraction than if I'm just like fully naked.
Absolutely.
But nothing showing, but I'm just fully naked. Yeah. That thousands and thousands and thousands of more.
And people will comment, take it off. And it's like, that's your comment on me playing the sonata? I mean, it's so weird. I mean, people are weird.
But that's why, like, what I'll say is that this is a tool in LA. It looks like they're a tool. They help, without a doubt. But I don't want that to be my focus. I always say I would rather someone compliment my comedy or my bartending skills or my editing ability or my production quality over my looks any day. And that's why I don't leave with it. That's why I've stayed away from doing something like OnlyFans. That's why if you go on my Instagram, it's not all pictures of me, nothing but like shirt. I mean, they're in there because I got to play the game. We all got to play the game. But I try hard not to.
And this is what I like about your podcast, Messy Podcast. You're casual. You're come as you are. You talk about.
I don't even shower for that podcast.
It looks like it. He, Honey Badger don't care. Like,
I don't give a shit. Because at the end of the day, we could look good. It's a job, though, to look good. We all know how much work it takes to look good. It's hard. Bitch, you look good. Don't you?
Girl, COVID's not been nice to me.
What do you mean? I think you look great.
You're so sweet.
But it's you know, like, at the end of the day, this is a lot of work, and I'm not a person that wants to be known for it. I don't really care. I use it as a tool. I think like, oh, I'm blessed. Let me do it.
Marketing.
But I want to be known for my comedy at the end of the day and my skill, because that's what's going to take you farther.
And I think it was you that said it, or it was an influencer that said, you know, I work hard on my body. I put so many hours a day. Sometimes I'm starving, whatever. I keep to my diet. So, yeah, I should be proud of not wearing my shirt. I should be using it because I put work into it.
You absolutely should. But it's sometimes... People are going to say mean things about your body no matter how perfect it is.
Well, that's true, because everybody has an idea of what's perfect. Like,
and then people
don't
even like
that. You're too big.
People don't even like their people that their preference isn't even someone that has a physique, or people like they like you know, slimmer people or whatever. It's like there's always, you're never going to fill everyone's check mark.
Oh yeah, some people, and then you know that's why people will edit their photos or like get surgeries and stuff like that. And everybody edits their stuff. The trick is just not make yourself look unrecognizable when I see you in person.
Right. A little judge.
Just a little tweak.
Just a little judge.
Make sure there's no warps in the back. Someone actually exposed me
that's
recently.
The worst. It's when the door is like don't.
Oh, I mean, even the little ones. Someone I don't know who they are, and I wouldn't ever give them that promo. But they, it's someone who like exposes fitness influencers. And there's a fitness influencer MikeMGTV, first of all, what? And they went through every single one of my Instagram photos ever, zoomed
obsessed.
Into the pixels, found any warps, and made like three reels about
ridiculous.
Me, and sent all their audience over to be like, you fat, you Photoshop king. I'm like, first of all, fitness influencer?
You're like, forget that.
You think I'm skinny?
But here's the thing. Hollywood has been doing it, a magazine since the silent picture.
I mean,
is part of celebrity. Your photos are going to be photo-touched or photoshopped. They're going to be touched
there's
up.
There's a standard.
Well, I mean, there's so many different, like, I mean, they'll take your head in one photo and put it on the body that you put in another photo because you're flexing in that photo, but you weren't in that one. Your face looks better in that. Like, it's just all...
As a model, wouldn't you say that there's... It's not whether or not you retouch your photos. That's standard. That's a standard amount of editing that we all do, and no matter what. You know what I mean? Whether it's sharpness.
If you're a model, nobody wants to see a pimple on your butt. Like, you're going to blur it out.
It's some photographers see it as like part of their art. You know, some have like a stylistic approach to what. So every photo that they have of someone is going to look a certain direction. So, yeah, no, of course they don't have perfect skin in real life, but they're going to look like. They have, you know, great skin in this photo because that's just the style of the photographer.
Yeah. Every photo you post is literally an ad for yourself. Mm-hmm. Imagine if they posted an ad for the Kardashians on a billboard that wasn't photo. Never. Yeah. It would never happen.
What was it? Like Chloe's grandmother posted an unshopped photo of her and it went viral.
And then her grandma died the next day. Like, oh, God.
Oh, no.
One of the Kardashians, Chloe, was on the Good Morning America. It was so embarrassing. She had nothing to say. And poor Hoda is like, so how about those Dodgers? Yeah. She literally had nothing.
No.
But she talked about, I designed his tattoo and I did cursive like.
She looked great
and
at Beyonce's
stopped.
Party. I saw that.
Girl. Mike, I want to talk about growing up very Italian.
Oh, yes.
We know from any kind of cultural conservative environment, you know, masculine roles are very we know what a masculine role in a family is, mm-hmm. As well as feminine roles. I want to know what it was like growing up in that kind of conservative environment where there was such strict role, so to speak, which you've kind of broken through this whole feminine, masculine, bi, fluid, whatever. But it comes from this conservative foundation. So how did you move through that?
It's weird where it was like it was economically conservative, but it was liberal for the time. And when I say that, like back when in the 90s, my mom loving the show Will and Grace was like, oh my God, yeah, we can watch Will and Grace. Like, you know what I mean? Yeah. We love The Nanny. We always watched that during, like, you know, so it was more so there was never a, you know, you can't be gay, don't be a sissy boy. It was, you know, trying to lead me in a way because, I mean, growing up for someone with my dad who was more of like the leader in that, he was never like made fun of me or bullied me or made me feel bad. He was like his high school bully. So when I was feminine, he thought I was opening myself up to being bullied. Mm. So when he would put me in sports and when he would do this and stuff, like put that pressure, that wasn't really him trying to bully me. It was in his way, him trying to protect me, which was wrong. Well, not the right thing to do. Any parents out there, just tell your kids they're perfect the way they are. You don't have to do anything to prove. But my dad didn't know that. And he knows that now. Do you know what I'm saying? So it was a lot of pressure. But the good thing about it is I met all those requirements. And even though it sucked at the time, like I broke basketball championship records. I can't even play basketball anymore. I did it at the time. I was a football captain. I was the only like freshman who played varsity every single year. I hate football. Do you know what I mean? I also talked like this for like the first like 15 years of my life. It was ridiculous.
Half of our audience just fainted dead away.
But it was, you know, now that I'm out and I live, like, you know, proud and everything like that, I'm like, you know, you guys made me do this to prove that I wasn't going to be that queer kid, that I wasn't going to be that little feminine boy that the parents in town used to cancel playdates with me with because they didn't want their kids to catch the gay.
Wow. Mm.
So now, like, I beat all your kids. I did all those things that was supposed to prove how straight and masculine it was. I'm gay as fuck.
We also have to remember your parents came from a generation where people were dying for being gay.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. And that's why, you know, my dad watched an episode of Pose and called me like in tears because in the first episode.
Pose changed a lot of people. I cried from the bad acting, but that's another story.
Oh my God. But like the first episode where the kid gets thrown out of his house, my dad was like, oh my God, I feel like that's how you felt I was for you and all these things. And every week since he's asked me, are you on prep? Oh, you want prep?
That's so cute. Like, he thinks that's what we should be having conversations with our kids.
I just ask him the same question. I'm like, are you on prep?
My mom hasn't even had the sex talk with me about straight people. I'm still
yeah, my parents avoided that conversation too.
And you know, there was this weird obsession about your sexuality. And I know in some interviews you say, you know what, I'm done talking about my sexuality. And then you talk about it for the whole interview. Or that's what they edit in.
Yeah.
Because media is obsessed with that. It's like, what business is it and why are we trying so hard to put you in a box that we can own or understand?
Yeah.
And then it's this, well, you know, he's passable. So if he sleeps with guys, he's passable. And it goes to that same bullshit of feminine and masculine.
Well, I like talking about it with you guys because I like talking about being gay.
I'm so sick of talking about gay people. I tell you though.
But even on Lindsay Lohan's Beach Club, I was the gay one.
Yeah.
And to the point where when they cast me on the show, I was with a girl for half the show. That wasn't their storyline, so they fired the girl, sent her home, flew out Alex. I'm gonna say his name. They flew out Alex, who's on the show, because they wanted me to be with him, but he had a boyfriend. But here,
and he's right here. No, it's getting right.
And they're both here.
Yeah,
actually.
Yeah. But their whole shit was, oh, so Mike, are you gonna hook up with Alex? I'm like, yeah. They're like, the drama. What's his boyfriend gonna think? I'm like, well, I hooked up with both of them, and they're open, so they probably won't give a shit. And they're like, oh. They had no idea what to do.
But then it goes to being that token. It's like, you're going to use me for the gay story.
It was the gay one.
The gay drama. And that's the only drama that gays have is that they see. But that's funny because that's actually not the drama that gays have.
So, but this is what I liked about X on the Beach is that you didn't just, okay, you know, David Bard has a crush on me, so now we have to sleep together. Not all gay people are sleeping with all gay people, regardless of what you look like.
First of all, did David Bard have a crush on me? You're bi, you've never been with a man, you've never been romantically with a man.
Wait a minute, we can't. But
we can't. I'm not discrediting anybody's sexuality. I support him no matter what, and I've did nothing but
I come from. Just keep in mind, I come from your group too.
However,
but what I've been.
I was available for him. And he went for every girl in the house. And honestly, if he is bi, then I'm insulted, David. What the hell, man? No, he's bi. I know David's fluid. He wouldn't lie about that.
No, but I think, because I know David's done the show like 4 times.
Yeah.
In my mind, he gets to a certain point in his female relationships, and then he's done. I think it's fear of sex, not fear of sex, but maybe
intimacy
of like crossing that certain line. Intimacy. I think it's more that than having to say fluid or pan or whatever.
He has a lot. I mean, I'm not going to tell the tea, but David has a lot that he's personally going through that he talks to me personally on the side. But I would say he's growing as a person. He's doing really, really well. but I will say the reason, I mean, I give him shit, but you would be surprised the amount of people who fake being queer because it's more okay now. It's just like the straight people who pretend to be gay to promote their OnlyFans. It's same thing.
All the queer baiting is
because
kind of obnoxious.
Getting on MTV shows is easier for them because they could check 100%. That social box.
Being a gay porn star earns more money, you know, like 500% more money than being a straight porn star. That's why you have straight men actually doing gay porn.
And this is what I'm saying. So like just how you were like, well, we're not going to, you know, we have to accept everybody for their sexuality. I'm like, yes, but I'm going to call out bullshit when bullshit is bullshit. 100%. Because you're not, I will accept you if you're actually that. But there's no one who would it just bothers me.
But there's also a double standard. It's like, because David has a great physique and he's handsome and he's got a great ass, whatever. No, but it's like, we need him to be gay because then he's one of us.
But then you have these guys that are gay baiting, queer baiting, or whatever. The gay community is part of the problem because you have all these gays that just like eat it all up. And I'm like,
they're living a fantasy and it's not cool.
It's no. Case in point. And that's gross in general. And like, you have these, you know, gays that are obsessed with straight men. It's like, okay, you know, like.
Case in point, James Corden plays gay in The Prom. We tear him to shreds. Gay needs to play gay. Trans needs to play trans. Everywhere. Stanley Tucci plays another gay guy. We love him. Harry Styles, because we have a crush on him, kisses another guy in his new film that he plays gay. People are commenting on him because he's a wacko.
I think we're getting tired of Harry's antics.
But when the trailer first hit of him and the policeman, we thought there was praise, nothing but praise that he's playing a gay man and he's gotten in touch and he had a gay kiss and it was made a big deal. Not one gay person said, hey, gay should be playing gay. They announced today Matt Bomer is going to be playing a trans character. But it's fine because he's hot and we have a crush on him.
Well, I mean, did you hear what Harry said recently about that only gay sex has been represented on television and movies as them just going at it and like it's not like a really intimate kind of thing
romantic.
And it's just like and people got really angry about that because what are you doing judging or trying to say what intimacy is like between two men?
I mean, do gay men have intimacy anymore? I'm really serious.
It's how you define what intimacy is. Intimacy doesn't necessarily have to mean sex.
It means you're bringing Panda Express home when I have a hangover. That's as intimate.
Hey,
like, that is 100%.
I stand by that.
Yes. Yeah. Let's watch a bad show, all 8 episodes, and that's all the intimacy I need.
Intimacy is just like a connection, really. It doesn't have to be a physical.
I feel like I just don't care about sexuality stuff at all. People make such a big deal about it. Like, it's all groundbreaking. I'm like, fuck whoever. Why are we talking about it?
But it's the media's fault because now we grab a headline. You know, I write for 2 gay magazines. Mm-hmm. And so every pitch I get is gay actor plays this part. Gay singer unleashes new album. Yep. It's like, okay, what's the headline here?
The singer. It doesn't have to be like gay singer.
And I hate it when people
a gay parody, then fine, it's gay.
Well, even stuff like people on YouTube, that's their skill. Like, I'll see people where their whole YouTube channel or social media presence is like, this is me and my boyfriend's Instagram. Everyone follow it. It's separate from our personal Instagram and it's not different, but follow it.
And all the
think everyone cares.
Yeah.
Or it's like, follow my YouTube channel where it's my boyfriend challenge. Me and my boyfriend make dinner. Me and my boyfriend this. And I love that. I love seeing queer relationships and everything, but like, what I want to comment is, what else?
What's your identity outside of that?
Yes. And so TikTok influencer Ian Padgett came on the show, and he was very open. He and his boyfriend started their TikTok career together.
Yes.
And it became a job, and he was so honest. He says it ruined our relationship.
Yep.
If we wouldn't have started doing TikToks together, we would still be together. Yep. We had this love, but it became a job, and you didn't see the other person as a real person. Yeah. You saw him, how are they going to look on here? Do we need to, I mean.
I sat behind his ex, Chris, at the VMAs.
I'm sure you did.
And I DM'd him. He didn't say hi, but we had a great talk.
Where did you DM him?
I DM'd him on Instagram. I said, I hope you had a great time at the VMAs. It was great talking with you. That's all.
Are you on the apps?
Honestly, not anymore.
Oh, what
recently?
Made you,
not anymore.
What made you delete?
Walking away from it all.
Okay, so we're gonna do our pop culture report, and then after that, Mike came out publicly a few days ago on his YouTube channel and says he is walking away. And it was so intense because I was listening to your pod and I was listening to your YouTube channel as I was doing research and other stuff. I literally sat and I was like, oh, crap, what's he walking away from? And you bear it all. And you're going to talk about what it is you're walking away from.
Yep.
But we need to loosen up before we get all that. So without further ado, we are going to get a little pop culture report. Tony, take it away.
On the Rocks is proud to present Pop on the Rocks, your daily dose of Dehler with your host, Steven Dehler, bringing us the latest dish in pop culture. Take it away, Steven. I'll be in the corner drinking.
The guy with muscles asked me to open this.
I don't know how to open a flask.
That's so funny.
I've never used a flask in my entire life, so I have no idea how to open one. All right. Well, so it was a busy weekend this last weekend. We had the D23 Expo, which, I mean, my Twitter was filled up with all that information, but
they put on a good show.
Well, they did. They did put on a good show. It just, but what was the backlash from it was just all the racism with Halle Bailey's The Little Mermaid reveal. Mm. I'm really confused as to why people were even like surprised. I mean, it was announced like 3 years ago that she was in it, but I thought, I mean, I just,
people went crazy when they announced what's her name? Zegler from West Side Story is going to play Snow White. They're mm-hmm. like, well, she can't be Latina and Snow White. And it's like, why?
I mean, she looks perfect for
it
that
doesn't
role.
Matter.
But, I mean, but it doesn't even matter. It's the whole premise of the, like, let's say Ariel. Ariel's whole premise is that it was about this. She had the best voice
she's
in the ocean.
She's a mermaid.
That's
she's
all
owned
that
fish.
It's all that mattered. She had the best voice in the ocean and she's a fish.
Yes.
That's all that matters.
And she gave up her voice. For sex.
Yes.
She literally
honestly,
for a pair of legs, for some sickening legs. Okay.
And honestly, a print. Like,
yeah. If that's how it was done, we didn't have to go to the gym and squat every day, West Hollywood would be silent.
I'm just excited for her to kill all the outfits, like that sparkly look at the end of the
movie. I'm not excited for Melissa McCarthy to sing Unfortunate Souls.
I mean, yeah, well, yeah. I mean, that was not even really sung in the first. I mean, she does have kind of a Ursula laugh, like Melissa McCarthy. I'm not really afraid of her doing that role, but I mean, I'm afraid of how it's going to be kind of edited.
So,
like, how's she going to look?
Can I do a little devil's advocate with.
You always do.
I know. Because I love it, because we don't always agree on everything. I will tell you why I responded with rolled eyes to Little Mermaid. I am sick of the live-action remakes. Pinocchio was a disaster. Aladdin was a disaster. Lion King was a disaster. So I'm enough of this, and I think
they're doing Lilo and
Pinocchio
Stitch.
Pinocchio was so bad. I don't know what Tom Hanks was doing.
It was. But that was directly to Disney Plus, which is
But it's awful. But my thing is like, are they now just casting? And I think Hollywood grabs onto an idea, and then it's like everything has to be changed, which. Does it make me racist?
It does, I guess in the live-action era, because they're literally making a live-action version of all the original.
But are they doing it just to get this chatter?
No, can I?
I think they did one in the.
I think we're forgetting that these movies are for kids. We grew up with these movies and we're like judging them. We're kids who like they were so impactful for us because we were like five.
And kids don't know color.
But like we're watching it now and we want it to hit us the same way. And of course it's not gonna. But like this is supposed to be nostalgic for us. I'm not expecting it to break cinematic records.
Well,
that's a really good point.
Well, because the whole thing about the millennial generation is that we are the nostalgic generation. That's why we have all these reboots. And we have all these remakes and all that. Like, I mean, not even in every part of media right now, like video games, movies, television, everything is being remade or redone or rebooted because we are that nostalgic generation. I mean, that's really what the millennial generation has become, kind of.
But to that point, like if like Snoopy all of a sudden was red the next day, I would be like, that's not Snoopy.
That's Pig, the red dog.
but you know what I mean? It's like,
I loved that book.
I know what you're saying, where there's like we affix ourselves to an idea or something.
Yes.
So I do see that kind of uncomfort when you see it totally change. It's like, that's not what I love.
And then you have these grown ass people that are just like bitchy about, you know, frivolous stuff.
I saw someone try to do a flip argument on, there was a black woman on TikTok who tried to actually come for their own community and be like, you guys
Rachel
are.
Rachel Dozier.
But they were like, you guys are like all hypocritical because imagine if they came out with a live action Princess and the Frog and made Tiana white, you guys would lose your shit. And I said, hold on. But that is the only black princess.
And that movie's already an issue in the first place because she's a frog throughout the whole movie.
And I was like, if they made the only black princess ever white, that's why that's the problem. That's why we're doing this. So we could cast whoever can play the role.
Yeah.
It should be everybody. So that argument was invalid.
And also, I feel like, I mean, I see a lot of the false equivalency of like, oh, what if, you know, they made Black Panther white? I mean, the whole premise of like Wakanda is that it's like a secluded African nation, and like that's complete, like it's just all these false equivalencies, and it's like having to explain these things. He doesn't, you know, it's just so tiring to have to explain this to these people anymore. But they're going to be racist regardless.
Yeah.
But.
Well, and I think maybe it affects us, even though like I claim I'm not racist, but it has like how I was grown and what I think. Oh. Is how it should be, and it's all these what makes us uncomfortable, which we have to look at what makes us uncomfortable.
Yeah,
you know, so mm-hmm. You know, it's
and then another, they also had, you know, they announced Little Mermaid, they announced Hocus Pocus 2, Disenchanted, Inside Out 2, with which Inside Out 2 I'm a little confused because they're bringing in new emotions, but
it didn't do well.
And the first movie they showed the adults with the same emotions as the kid, so I'm like, what new emotions are they going to show that they didn't show in the first one?
Because the movie didn't do well,
but they didn't show it in the first one.
If they don't bring in horny, I'll walk out.
They will suddenly.
They're going to call it something else. They're going to call it something like angst or something.
Yes!
It's definitely going to be angst.
It's going to be Randy Rainbow. He's going
to
be like.
Or something that you experience only through puberty. Because it has to be something that you only experience in your teenage years, because the adults aren't going to have these emotions anymore.
I mean, I love Pixar movies, so I'm down.
I like the first one. I mean, everyone was really sad when, was it Bing Bong died? And then they had let's move on to Marvel. And then they had Marvel, which they announced the Thunderbolts, Daredevil. So they interviewed Brie Larson on the red carpet, and they asked if she would play, like, if she's up to play Captain Marvel again. And she sort of did a little dig at, you know, her aunt. I don't know if you are aware, but Brie Larson has been trolled incessantly since the first Captain Marvel movie. Oh. These Marvel fan trolls that just go after her over and over again, saying that she's terrible and all this stuff. And she's really dedicated herself to that role. She still does all of her exercises for Captain Marvel because she's so dedicated to it.
Well, and we're talking about like body issues. Everybody focused that the joke was that she had no ass. It's like, how do you work out that much if you have no ass? And it's like,
they would show her ass in the costume next to, like, what was it, Tom Holland's ass. And, you know, you can't compare it to Tom Holland. That kid works out. But she looks great.
I don't ever envision Tom Holland working out. I think he's just born with
it. No one's ever going to be happy.
No one's ever going to be happy.
Either you have no ass, or, like, you have to be the people talking crap, being like, oh, my God, look at
their... And it's cultural. Italians?
If you have a big ass, people are going to be like, oh, that's a BBL. Like, they're making fun of you for it or whatever. Yeah.
It's a lot of misogyny, too. I mean, you see with all these shows and all these, you know, women-led shows, She-Hulk is really great because they're kind of self-aware about that. So when they have, they're very aware of the fact that they get that. And they actually shared some of the comments that they get online in the actual show as sort of like a meta kind of thing, because they are aware that, you know, a lot of female-led things. They even said, like, oh, we're going to call it the MCU now, which is something that they said online, and they use that in the show. So they are aware of that stuff.
Or the MCU LGBTQ.
That one.
Shade or no shade, I thought She-Hulk was a joke.
It is. It's supposed
I saw
to be.
The trailer.
Do you understand what the comic? Well, the whole comic premise is that, you know, she breaks the fourth wall. She's a cousin of the Hulk, and she becomes a Hulk because he gets her.
But she's a lawyer?
Yeah. That was always in the original series, yeah.
Honestly?
You know, I'm not a Marvel fan.
You're not a comic book person, so like you don't really like anything about those movies.
I am now.
I liked Thor. I saw Love and Thunder. Everybody trashed that movie. I liked it.
I haven't seen
it. That's like my least favorite movie.
It was fun.
I'm obsessed with Wanda.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
I'm obsessed.
I was really disappointed that they didn't announce, like, the most anticipated thing right now is, like, a Scarlet Witch solo movie, which they're supposed to be doing.
They had
her sign on for 7 more years.
But I think she's a smart actor, and she's like, you know, I need to do some other stuff and pepper that in. She's very smart.
She might be in season 2 of, what was it, the new Game of Thrones show.
She's so smart.
Who's stronger? I'm going to ask you. Wanda or Jean Grey?
See, that's really difficult, but I would say in the end I think Wanda would beat Jean Grey.
Like, but dark Wanda versus, because doesn't Jean Grey have like, there's like a white phoenix?
Well, there's just the phoenix force, and that takes over character. Yeah, that takes over characters, and Jean Grey is one of the characters that this dark phoenix force takes over, and that's why she becomes
nerdy
super,
gays, nerdy yeah, little gay boys,
and then the Death Star
came in.
This is what
happens to you when you grow up.
Yeah, we
you go to the gym and you stay nerdy.
Yeah, if don't get me started. I can talk about that all day long. I'm super, super nerdy about that. But yeah. Let's move on. So you actually were there this weekend. Lady Gaga brought her Chromatica ball to the Dodger Stadium.
Yes, it was my first Gaga concert.
It was your first?
I've only been to 3 concerts. That was my 3rd ever in my life.
Only 3 in general?
Yeah, I cried.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Was it great? How was it packed? I'm sure it was. Oh, I mean, she'd been selling out shows all over.
It was packed, and honestly, I had a friend who literally last minute, I was at the gym, and he was just like, hey, do you want to come like free Lady Gaga? Floor seats right in front of the stage. And I was just like, yeah, what? And he was like, yeah, let's go.
That's always amazing.
That's a good friend to have.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
I mean, he's very nice. He's a very good friend. And I was just like,
what's
thank
his
you
number?
So much. We asked the show. But no, he's very nice. We had so much fun. We were with a big group and it was so nice. And her performance was amazing. Like, the way she
she is a live performer.
She's not only a live performer, the way she talks to the audience and engages.
Yeah, yeah. She's very, I mean, you just feel so good after. I went to her art pop concert, so like, and that was at the Staples Center. And she's just, I mean, it's a completely different experience.
What I've heard from people going to the concert from whatever town that she's in is that the crowds are respectful. It's not like a concert where people are like trying to kill themselves to get out. Everybody's like, there's this feeling of family.
Yeah, yeah. And everyone's just gay.
Everyone's just gay. Everyone's
even for a day.
Gaga outfit.
Even David Bart is gay.
Yes. Everybody's concerned about one thing: watching her or like turning a look. That's it.
Of the looks I've seen are just like, girl, you're at a concert.
But it was hot and sweaty, and by the time we got there, I was a mess. So
it was really hot in LA.
I mean, because it's all the way up at Dodger Stadium. That's a pain to get over to in that area.
Did they serve Dodger dogs?
I had a few. I did, yeah.
But you're good.
I love that.
All right, so next up we had, so they revealed the Dancing with the Stars cast.
I feel mixed about this cast.
I do.
I'm on it.
At first, I was like, you know, waiting to hear what they were saying. But I'm actually kind of like the cast based on former years. They haven't really had really good people.
They were smart with the announcement because they led with the who.
Yeah, they definitely led with like.
And I thought this is trash.
Obscure. Like,
yeah, who's
no
on it?
Well, Selma Blair, Cool Intentions. You know, and she suffers from MS, so you know.
This is why she's doing it. She's bringing awareness to it, and she's also bringing awareness as like. You work through it.
Yeah, because she had chemo, stem cell transplant, so she's in remission for it. But yeah, she still suffers from it. And then Real Housewife Teresa. Okay, I always butcher her last name.
Judy Chek. You're Italian.
If someone dies, you know she's like best friends with my aunt. If someone dies in my family, they all show up. I love it.
How about when she was? when she was doing a recipe and she says, "Then you add the cumin."
No, that wasn't her. Was that her?
Girl, Danielle Staub was on the show, by the way.
Oh, I thought that was just they made fun of her on Drag Race.
No, she really did it.
That.
She said, you had to come in. I'm a really good
So there's the Jordan Sparks, American Idol.
Okay. Great.
Jason Lewis from Sex and the City. Ugh. Wayne Brady. And
Brady's a dancer, though, so that's unfair. He's like
Well, also, Shangela from RuPaul's Drag Race. She's on it. She's going to be the first queen on the American version. As we know, Courtney Act was on the Australian version. But she's a dancer, too, so I'm excited to see Shangela. She will turn it out.
You know what? It's about time Shangela wins something.
You know, I really thought she was robbed from that All-Stars.
She was.
I feel like she was.
It was set for Tracy.
Is there anything that Shangela will say no to?
No. Shangela's
amazing. Shouldn't say no in this industry. It's definitely not the time
to say
no.
She's like, she did the reunion for 90 Day Fiancé. She had never seen the show in her life. She's like,
Shangela's a reality
star. So you love each other?
Yeah.
She was at the Walmart in San Ysidro at the border. Turn and look.
She's a reality star above all else. Like,
she hustles.
Yeah, you got to be a drag queen to get on Drag Race. Born.
And she had so much fun in Puerto Vallarta while we were all dying in LA from COVID.
There's quite a few of those that were there.
Anyway,
should we move on to our doozy?
I love pop culture. Yes.
Let's move on to our
doozy. We actually have show and tell.
We do have show and tell. We have a little clip this time because it would be just too much to try to explain without hearing it.
Without further ado, Tony.
Yes.
So
we have Erica Jane, and she's defending herself right now about the whole, you know.
And Sutton's been on the show.
It's not about just law.
And we have Kim, or Kyle. So I always get Kim and Kyle.
Is she slurring her words?
I mean,
were they
defrauded
by Girardi Keys? Not by Erica Girardi. Were they defrauded by Girardi Keys? Guess what? I don't work at Girardi Keys.
Like
I'm not a licensed lawyer. I don't
But she spent Girardi money.
You know, and so she's not innocent in any of this. But
no, this isn't, whether she's
That's
innocent
to be
or not,
at
she doesn't
and be
give
found
a fuck.
That's the thing.
No
she does not care. She's not showing. She's very callous about this.
No, that's very true. You have to give that to her. She's slurring her words. Erica sounded like she's slurring her words, too.
Actually, I actually like Kyle.
Let's have a little sensitivity to the victim.
Who kind of is like just really a story mover at this point? She's actually standing up to Erica, being like, "I'm trying to be your friend.
Yeah.
I can't defend."
Well, other people are saying that she's not really trying to be her friend. She's more of like, "Stop saying this because I don't want you to like say this on camera," kind of thing.
Exactly
more of a thing, less than like you know.
I heard that Rinna's out.
Rinna, I heard that as well.
I hope so because she's trying to come for Kathy.
Yeah. And then Kathy out of nowhere telling.
She's the comedian.
Kathy telling Kyle to like stop using curse words. I mean, come on.
Because Kathy doesn't give a shit about this.
Well, she just she just needed her like 2 seconds on camera.
Who's hunky dory? I mean, that'll go down to
homeless, not too.
Yeah, and here she is just saying that she can't. She has no compassion for these people. I didn't realize that people died.
Don't keep saying it, please.
That's what Kyle was saying, that people had died.
Yeah, you didn't know that?
No.
Yes, it was no. They stole money from the families of like people, like their plane crash victims and stuff like that.
Jesus.
So like people died, and like when you die, your family is supposed to get recompensated for that, and they took the money that they were supposed to get.
Because like,
I mean, that's definitely a doozy of the week. I mean, when I saw that, because I used to watch Real House with Beverly Hills all the time, but I was on when Erica was first on the show, I was on that episode in San Diego when she went down to perform. I was there with like dancing with the crew and crap, but that went south for her really quickly.
It was just I feel like she doesn't. There's just like a an alter of reality. She doesn't know where
she got into her bubble, and this happens with a lot of stars. I think it's happened with Lady Gaga, by the way. They get into their bubble and they forget where they come from, and they forget about reality. And you know, Bravo TV kind of supports that.
Oh,
like
yeah.
NeNe Leakes big for her
Whatever brings them the viewers, and that's all they care about.
They're behind the scenes telling us the craziest things.
Oh, 100%.
And I'm at the point where I'm like, I literally, on my last shows, I look at the producers and I look at them and I'm like, we are not friends.
Well, and they pit producer against producer to see which storyline gets, because then they get a commission or whatever.
Yeah.
Steven Dehler, thank you for that dose of Dehler pop culture.
You are welcome.
Okay.
Huh?
Oh God, flirting on your own time. Okay.
So dumb.
Two bottoms to make a right. Anyway, no, just kidding. Allegedly. So Mike, I want to talk about the message that you sent your fans. So your YouTube is really fun. Sometimes it's you casual, just talking to the camera. A lot of times you're talking about bartending.
Yes.
You're sharing cocktail tips. You're sharing fun tips. So well edited, so well produced. It is a full-blown show.
Yeah.
And then you came out with a video that says, I'm walking away. And I'm like, oh, here we go. Another clickbait where it's like, I'm walking away from Walmart. You know, like, whatever.
And I'm leaving YouTube, but not really.
Yeah.
Buy my book.
So then I started listening. Like I said, I had it on the background and, you know, I was taking notes and I was doing other stuff. And then I was stopping. I was like, oh, you're really like having a moment with us. And I think this message is really important. Not just for the LGBTQ community, but also beyond, because sometimes we get so wrapped up in life that we forget what we're doing day to day, what our goal is, what makes us happy for real.
Yeah.
So can you share about what it is you're walking away from and how you're going to kind of work through that?
I am walking away from kind of like the party scene in West Hollywood and just Hollywood in general and everything. I'm kind of at a point where I had like a lot of things that like I dealt with growing up, and I feel like a lot of them are coming back up.
Mm.
And there are things that I know I can't handle, I shouldn't do, I don't want to do. And it's not me being preachy or judgy. I'm not like here to like send a message of sobriety, because I'm far from it. I'm still going to drink. There's just other things and substances and stuff like that that I don't want to do, and not only do, be around. And sometimes it's even hard for me to go out and support my friends and be in the queer culture and West Hollywood and everything, because a lot of my friends not only feel comfortable knowing that about me, doing it in front of me, they push it on me. Because I'm the kind of person where, like, I will say no. But at the 10th time when you put something in my face that I told you I really don't want to do, if I do it once, it'll be 2 days later and I'm going to be going down a spiral. And I don't like to be that person. Then I wake up the next day feeling embarrassed. And I'm a much different person when I'm in that state. And I didn't want to do that anymore. You know what I mean? There's nothing wrong with that. If you want to have fun, do it, everything. But I just want something different for myself, and I want to focus. And that's what I make these things called heart to hearts, because my YouTube channel is more therapy for me than anything else. And I feel like a lot of people relate to them, and that's why they do so well.
Yeah.
Because I'm like a person online who
just
talks
like on reality TV, like you're real. You're not playing a part.
Yeah, I don't care. Like at the end of the day, I started my YouTube channel because I was like, I have no one I can relate to in my hometown. And YouTube is where like I see these weirdos who are going on YouTube to be weird, and they're accepted to be weird. Mm. So I can turn on the camera and just like talk for 30 minutes to be uninterrupted. And then I get to watch it back to remind myself later down the road. So, like, when I said I'm walking away from it all, it had really nothing to do with the content that people were receiving on YouTube. That's about me and my personal life. So people get a glimpse about me as a person, not just who I am on YouTube. And I did it. I do these all the time. It's like if I go through a breakup or if I do this and that, and I don't, you know, put anybody else's info out there. But the heart-to-hearts are great because not only is it a venting session for me, people out there, you know, who I don't know where you are in the world, but when I was a kid and I didn't have anybody to talk to in my hometown, I would go to YouTube to find people that I could relate to and make me feel not so alone. So there could be somebody that's going to be like, oh, there's this person that I love watching who, like, I love their videos and I love their content. I'm a fan of that person. And oh my God, they're going through something like me. And I don't know anybody else who's going through that like me.
And you also own it. Like, if you have a misstep, if you get back to certain things and then you get back on track, I think a lot of people don't realize the pressures that are in the LGBTQ nightlife community.
Yes.
It is drugs. Drugs are everywhere. Whether you can fit it into your business life and make it work, some people can't.
Yeah.
There are professional partiers out there.
Yep.
Yeah. And let me know, like, sometimes it's fun, and it's not all the time, but there are times where, like, one's all it takes. And then it's kind of like, you know, sometimes it's not a problem. Sometimes it was like, well, that was fun. And then other times you wake up and being like, I wouldn't have done any of that if I was thinking clearly. I wouldn't have said any of that. I wouldn't have. I am like, and then it could all come to bite you in the ass, being people who like work in entertainment and do what we do. I always think, what if someone has like a snapshot or like a screenshot, or what did I send? What did I do? Because you never know who's going to come out of the woodwork and try to like hold something against you or use it against you.
Especially in today's cancel culture.
Yeah.
And plus, I don't know about anybody else, but like the older I get, the hangovers are worse.
Terrible.
The blackouts are worse. It's like, and then you look at your bank account and you're like, I bought Frank's? Like, when was I going to go to France? Like, what? You know?
Yeah. The other day, it was in the morning, and I texted Steven being like, hey, are you going to the gym today? And then I paused. I'm like, I wonder if he thinks if I'm actually going to the gym or think I'm like, is he still up?
Yeah, I'm like literally at the gym right now.
And I was like, I'm going to try to go. And then I went to bed and said, yeah. I was like, anything.
But I think it's so important that you do share with your fans, because younger people do struggle, and especially people that come to LA, you know, everything's in lights, and they feel like to be the cool kid, they have to subscribe to a certain way or do certain things. And it's lost lives, and it's broken down lives. But also you have to look at who's succeeding in the industry and who's not.
Yes. And I'm like I said, I'm not Mother Teresa. I'm not going to preach to you.
But that's the best kind of person to share this kind of talk with.
And also at the same time, I don't regret a goddamn thing I've ever done. Let me tell you right now, what I'm happy is, like, I played the game, and I've gotten a lot from this that a lot of people, a lot of friends and people in my social circle, I think, you know, admire, even though they kind of like shit on me for it. Like the amount of people that discredit all the TV shows I've done, who will ask me to, hey, can you share my, like, I'm hosting at Mickey's, or like, this is my new single, can you share this for me,
or tag you? And it's
at the same time, have never shared a single video I've ever posted. Nothing like that. And I'll do it because I don't care. But there, it's this world where, like, I've done it, I don't regret any of it, I was happy, I've gotten a lot out of it, to the point where people have tried to discredit me to bring me down. And
there's sort of a cap on what you can get out of it.
There's a cap, and it's being able to pull yourself out of West Hollywood, because I tell people all the time, my only warning about West Hollywood is it's a lot of fun, but it is a black hole.
And it's not the end-all be-all for people that think, if I don't make it in West Hollywood, I'll never do anything else. That's not the truth.
That's what I was saying. It's a black hole because people make it in West Hollywood, and then they get safe and satisfied and stop being hungry.
And it's with any click. You know, yes. It's like, just think outside the box. And so I really appreciate you sharing that.
Yeah, no, it's true. Because listen, like the queens are fun. We have fun.
It's hard because you lose a lot of friends. You lose a lot of friends that way. You know, you get all these friends in that nightlife aspect where you're used to doing, you know, late nights and all that stuff. And you think you're like connecting with each other. And then when you decide to sort of steer out into a different direction that might not mesh with their direction, it's like, oh, cool. So then, you know, that sort of distance. And then you sort of find out.
Yeah.
You know, I kind of went through a similar thing where, like, I used to be out all night, all the time after work and all that kind of stuff. And then eventually I just was like, I like the gym so much more than I like partying. Yeah. And so I just sort of stopped. And after that, I sort of stopped talking to a lot of the people I used to be around.
Yeah.
But you also start focusing on different things. Now you have time. You wake up a little clear-headed to work on your YouTube channel.
Yeah.
Or to send a press release or to work on another project.
You know, honestly,
before noon.
Oh, my God.
Allegedly.
I'm doing a whole fitness regimen right now. Because
you're a fitness influencer.
Well, I know. There's a future thing, Mystery, that might be coming up soon. So I have to get my body ready. But it has me waking up at 5 in the morning.
Aren't you going to be gone for a period of time?
Yes.
And I've been seeing you in the gym in the mornings. Usually I see you there in the afternoons.
Yeah, I go in the mornings now, and then I get home and my editing's done. It's noon, and I've done everything. I'm like, well, what do I do? So I've actually got a full-time job now on top of it because I'm like a workaholic. I just want to make like more money and be more successful. And I've done the party thing, and this is what I'm saying. I'm still going to drink.
It's a different kind of party. You can still party, but you don't need to be like...
You're just not going
to
get arrested.
I want to get a high from going on a hike in Malibu.
Oh, fuck you.
No one gets that.
Get out of my way.
No.
I want to do that.
I know you don't like hikes. Anyway.
Oh, no. I do like hikes.
But
like
Runyon is not hiking. Runyon Canyon is not hiking.
I didn't say Runyon.
I know, but I'm saying, but he said he likes hikes. But Runyon Canyon is not hiking.
Whatever gets your high. Like, for me, if I sit down and write a short story, that gets me, like, you know.
Editing.
What kind of short stories do you write?
With horses.
Do you really write
those
stories?
Are my stories.
Yeah, girl, I'm like a real writer. Published.
I want to do with some stories.
Okay. I'll write your life story. I'll ghostwrite your life story.
Really? Will
yes.
You? Okay, now I know who to contact.
They know, yeah, right?
It's very dark and sad. I hope you're down.
There'll be a chapter called David Parton.
He wishes. He wishes he'd be a chapter.
I love David so much. All right, so we have to wrap up. Mike, what is your message to your fans?
My message is I didn't find the people in my life until I learned to love myself and be unapologetically myself. So if you're afraid to be unapologetically yourself, all you're doing is keeping away the people that actually matter and love you for you. So there's nothing to be afraid of.
100%. You know, the joke is like, if you can't love yourself, it's like, okay, we all know that line. It's true.
Yeah.
So, Mike, where do you want people to find and follow you?
You could find me everywhere at MikeMGTV or my podcast, MessyPod, that I co-host with my friend Mac Does It.
Yes.
That's it.
Awesome.
That's it.
Oh, and there they are.
Oh, look at that little idiot. He's so stupid and famous.
I don't know. Maybe we need to do a crossover episode.
Get him. We would love that. He would love
to
do
this.
Can you
imagine us two and them two?
Please come on out. Yeah.
Talk about messy.
Well, we got to get a little more professional because right now I'm in my living room doing, you know, it's a little messy.
You can come here.
Yeah, we would love to.
Right, Tony? We can come here.
Yeah, we'll do it here.
We should do
it. On the Rocks, messy.
Messy.
Except you'd be like, it's messy on the Rocks.
We should just do a Halloween episode because gays love that.
Oh, we have a game. Real quick, I'll tell you about it. We have a game called Will It Run Clear? I have a gold tray of 10 douches, and each douche has a different cocktail.
And on that note,
and you have to squirt it into your mouth.
Mike, we have Academy Award winners on our show. Steven, where can people find and follow you?
I'm just absorbing that information.
I know, me
real
too.
Quick. You can find me on Instagram at TheOnlySteven, and then on Twitter, my name, Steven Dehler, Dehler. And yeah, that's where you can.
I'm going to see a lot more of you because you're more available on Tuesdays.
Yes, I am more available. I quit dancing. I'm no longer dancing.
Me too. Well, that's all, folks. It's always a grab bag of fun here on The Rocks. A big thank you to our engineer, Tony Sweet, our social media clip editor, Alexis Mendez, our researcher, Mama Rose, also our in-studio help, AJ Sloan, today. Coming up, we have Academy Award nominee Virginia Madsen is coming on. We also have New Kids on the Block's Joey McIntyre and Broadway and film actor Nick Adams. Please like, share, subscribe so we can continue bringing this fabulous programming coming your way. Until next time, stay happy, stay healthy, stay sexy. More importantly, if you want. Stay tipsy.
No pressure.
Cheers.
No pressure.
Thank you, guys.
Another episode of On the Rocks. Tweet me and slide into my DMs on Twitter and Instagram at On the Rocks On Air. Find everything On the Rocks for free at ontherocksradioshow.com. Subscribe, like, review, and share. Until next week, stay fabulous.